So super excited here, speaking with Lucas Grassi again. I called you, I think, the godfather of Formula E, developed the first car. You're here now, season.
I don't like that statement at all, the godfather.
What should we call you?
The father is good enough.
Father, okay, fine. So you've seen every generation of Formula E. We're now here, Gen 3, the Evo cars, four-wheel drive. Just tell our viewers, what is exciting about this? What changes this season?
The car itself, the Gen 3, is essentially the same. But the main difference we have this year is that they allow us to use the front motor, which we already had last year, only for recuperating the energy under braking.
Last year.
They allow us now to use that same motor to accelerate the car. So we can recuperate and accelerate. We can recuperate at 350 horsepower, and we can accelerate with 75-80.
Okay.
Only.
Yeah.
But this 80 horsepower in the front axle makes the car goes from 0 to 62 miles per hour from 2.8 last year to 1.8 seconds this year. So it means two things. The car is faster than Formula One by 30% accelerating. And second, the acceleration is so intense that the car accelerates more horizontally than if being free dropped from a building.
You mean in terms of the balance of the car?
No,
if you dropped it, it's faster than gravity.
Yes, so it accelerates over 1G.
Okay.
So actually, if you drop the car, if you measure the speed after you drop it from a building in free fall, it will be slower than accelerating down the straight.
Do you feel that?
Yeah, of course. So that's the main change. On top of that, we have softer tires, so the car has more grip, and some aerodynamic changes in the front of the car that creates better slipstream, but also better looks.
Okay. So we know that the four-wheel drive is going to be on race start, some parts of qualifying, and attack mode.
Yes.
So the race start, we get it. You're going to accelerate quicker than the Formula One car. When you take attack mode, is it going to enable you to do different lines and corners, cutbacks, around the outside? Have you practiced that, or will we see coming up how that works?
We practice that a little bit, but you have to adapt in the race. So now in Formula E creates a very complex environment, which you need four different driving skills. Mm-hmm. You need to drive rear wheel only in qualifying, in which the energy does not matter. You can go use as much energy as you want, as far as you're fast. The same, but in 350 with four-wheel drive, which requires a different car balance and a different lines, because of course you can accelerate much faster. Then the 300 in race, which you need to be energy conscious, or conscious when you're actually driving the car, because you need to be as fast as possible, but with a given energy, and the same with 350. Mm-hmm. So you need to get the setup correct and your driving correct in a track that you only have 1 hour of free practice, four different types of drive. Mm-hmm. So it creates a lot of complexity, but creates also a lot of opportunities during the attack mode scenario.
So I want to go really deep into that. You said there's four different ways of driving. You now have to be not just a four-wheel drive driver and a rear-wheel drive, but different energy recuperation. That's a lot of things to think about. You've only got one free practice session. You spoke to us last year about having maybe like an AI helping you train yourself, or you can give that data to an AI and it will give you the best lines. Can you just explain again kind of how you may visualize kind of how you can use data and analysis to help you find your performance?
Yeah, so one of the projects that I'm currently working on, it will take a bit of time, but we are building up from scratch, is I'm creating a full virtual twin replica of an AI driver with my constraints, my personal technique, and my personal limitations, like, for example, reactions, time, force on the steering. So I put all this data into a model, and I allow this model to do a million laps over this track. And of course, if I was able to do a million laps, I would be a much better driver.
It would be here till year 3000.
Correct. So I put AI to do a virtual, or thousands of virtual races, and then I try to learn from what is my optimum maximum, where I can get to, how close I can get to that. Because it's not just a random AI that maybe you'll never be able to reach that. I would be able to reach that given enough time. Mm-hmm. So by having this reference, I can improve myself much quicker. Mm-hmm. So that's how I think AI will be a much better professor and tool than comparing data with your teammate.
I think there's, from top of my head, there's kind of two different applications for that. When you're at the highest level, you were at the highest level here. racing against incredible drivers. So that tiny edge is all important. Yep. You also have this massive body of people who are junior karters, sim racers, people racing for fun as a hobby. Yep. And they are using maybe ghosts, they are using telemetry of the fastest lap. And for them, that is an alien, right? They're like, my reaction time's not as quick. So they can also use something like that maybe to push themselves.
Yeah, correct. So for example, imagine a sim driver. The guy has an old Fanatec steering and the guy cannot afford a new one. So he's not comparing the data of what is achievable with the top of the game, Fanatec with a processor or with a $20,000 GPU that will make you faster. And he will never be able to reach that because he doesn't have the hardware. He can actually create a ghost based on his data and his inputs of what is the best he can achieve. And therefore, much more realistic learning. And I think that's how AI will change the learning in about motorsport. And also the AI could come with different strategies of opening a lap, closing a lap, choosing different lines, running different curbs in a different way that you might have not even thought was possible.
Counterintuitive.
And then you learn how to do that.
I think that's very exciting. So we'll watch this space. It's interesting you talking about this improvement because you're partnering Zane Maloney here, who's a rookie, but incredibly fast at the beginning of his journey. Do you think someone like Zane, over the next 10, 15 years of his career, is going to be using tools like this to get faster versus when you started? What's the difference?
Yeah, I already see a massive difference on the how well prepared are the young drivers. When I was Zane age, there was the simulator was very was very raw, was very undeveloped. You could not really learn anything. You did a little bit just to learn the track, more or less where the corner goes. Now you can have a 5-6K simulator at home that is super realistic. Yeah. So the drivers, they get prepared much earlier. I see I have a kid, my son is 6 years old. He's already driving for fun the Formula 3 in Interlagos.
In what sim?
In his sim.
In my home. In which game?
In our factory.
In our factory, yeah. Wow.
So he likes the Formula 3 car and he drives around Interlagos in a Formula 3 car, shifting up and down and driving around. Yeah. When I was 6 years old, I was going down the hills with, go-karts with the handbrakes. There was no tools to improve that fast. Yeah. So I think Zane generation already arrives much better prepared. He will use these tools during his career for sure. And then the younger generation will use even more. They will get developed already by AI. Zane generation was not developed by AI in terms of their progression from go-kart to racing. The next generation will. So it will only make the sport, I would say, less expensive in a way because you could
more meritocratic,
hopefully. The prices are still going crazy, so I don't want to. Money is still very important in motorsport, but hopefully we can make series, especially the junior series, with more meritocratic, more equipment equivalent, in which a better driver can really be in front of. If you spend a lot of money and time to practice more, because you already arrived better prepared at that stage.
Just having the best tires.
You take a guy, for example, like Lando Norris or even kids nowadays in Formula 2, you can buy a Formula 2 car, spend another 2 million euros, and drive a Formula 2 car, which is not the official one, 50 days a year.
Unlimited testing.
Wet
the track.
Correct.
Yeah.
While the guys that have a limited budget, they cannot do that.
Yeah.
They have to race only with a limited amount of practice that is given.
Is that a passion for you?
It's not it's a passion because I think it will make motorsport fairer and more meritocratic. At the moment, the only way a competent, talented driver like Lando Norris that spends tens of millions in extra testing, you will also have to spend these extra millions to be able to compete.
Yeah.
So it's and you see that more and more. So it's hard, and you want to see the best drivers getting there.
Just a final point on that before we turn to the team here. Karting, we know as you go up, there's still budget and all the equipment. Sim racing has generally been more meritocratic, but even now, you know, we have active pedals at home that move versus someone's gonna be on a Logitech that are not load cells and the direct drive. Do you see there like maybe an opportunity for some standardization of equipment to be fairer, or is there also going to be an arms race in sim racing because it's just more time you can spend? It's interesting to see karting also became too expensive and now sim racing is also...
Yes, I think there will be leagues inside the there will be leagues in sim racing which will probably be able to verify the hardware equipment that you're there, that is the right equipment for that series. Maybe there is an unlimited series that you can actually fake an AI. You actually could do a plug-in. Yeah, you could actually do a plug-in that is basically an AI driving for you.
Do you think that would be a big problem with some drivers faking it?
Yeah, for sure, because you could do a plug-in of an AI driving for you. It's just a matter of getting the inputs into the Fanatec software in the right moment, right? So it's feasible.
But one thing, Lucas, you can't have an AI faking you in this car 1.8 seconds accelerated. So let's talk about Lola, Amayar, Apt, so many iconic names in this team, iconic livery. Is this a project, or you know, how are you viewing this in terms of getting this team up to speed?
Yes.
Working with Zane, just tell us about that.
So for me, it is a long-term project. We are at the beginning of something. It's the first race ever for this team. So there is a huge mountain that we need to climb. The base is very good, so we have the right mountain equipment with us, but still the mountain is there. We need better integration. We need to run the car. We need to understand the car. We never did a race with this powertrain, but I'm very confident with Lola knowledge, Yamaha background, Abt experience, we can actually have a winning team in a few years' time in terms of title. I think this year we can actually fight for podiums and maybe a couple of races we can be fighting for wins. But we are not in a stage yet that we'll be able to fight with Porsche and Jag. We have to build it up.
So if people are looking for a more, say, an underdog team to support,
yes,
this could be the perfect team.
We are at the beginning of a journey. Very passionate people, a lot of interesting backers. And we're going to make it work sooner or later.
Okay, a few very quick fire questions. Favorite karting track?
Whoa.
Big choices.
Yes. One of my favorite karting tracks was the old circuit of Parma.
Pascal said that.
Really?
Yeah, the curbs.
Yes. So Parma was very cool, had a very long straight, high speed corners. I think they destroyed it. I raced there a couple of times in a trophy called Andrea Marguti, which was a racing driver that died in one accident. And they did that event every year. And for me, that was a very, very cool go-kart track.
Okay, I need to do some more history on that. Maybe we'll do a video and look at it and we'll come back to you for your thoughts. Your favorite overtaking move, like the trademark Degrassi, is it up the inside, cut back, around the outside? Or do you have many weapons?
No, I think the favorite overtake move, especially in this generation of cars, is where you actually go on the outside of the guy in front of the guy you want to overtake. So imagine I have two guys here and you are the third guy. Mm-hmm. You go on the outside of this guy, fight with this one, you lose the battle with this one, but you gain the position of the guy in front.
Okay.
So you attack the guy in front of you that you know you're going to lose, mm-hmm, but you gain from the guy that is just in front of you.
Yeah. Okay, wow, there's different levels to this game. Final question, if you could choose one circuit to come to Formula E, what would be your dream circuit?
Dream circuit? Macau, 100%.
Okay.
I really want, and I've been pushing Jeff, Alberto, everybody here, all the management like crazy, for us to go to Macau because Formula E is made for Macau. Mm-hmm. But also I want Formula E to race in Nordschleife.
Well, the full Nordschleife?
Full Nordschleife.
Even down the...
Three laps, four laps, doesn't matter. Everything, yes. You can have different power levels for different straights.
So use more down the straight.
You can actually limit the power to reach the top speed that you think is the maximum on each straight. So you can have like full power in some corners, in some sections, and automatically the car controls the power, because this we can do it Formula E. You cannot do it any other motorsport series. You can have different power levels that fits the track, but would be great to race in Nordschleife.
What lap time do you think you could do?
I don't know, but maybe in the guys in the team can try it out.
Okay,
the Gen 3 Evo
yeah.
in Nordschleife, flat out, 350 four-wheel drive, and see what lap times we do.
Okay, with mods, anything is possible, so I want to see people trying it. In fact, Lucas, I'm going to try it.
Okay, good.
And next time I see you, I'll let you know what I've done. It's always such a pleasure to talk with you. You're so knowledgeable.
Thank you very much.
Not the godfather, the father of Formula E.
Yeah, the cousin.
Until you run the whole thing, then we can say it. Yeah, best of luck, honestly, in your home E-Prix as well.
Thank you.
Awesome.